Hello friends, I am Dr. Ravinder Pal, teacher, educator, and today we are going to talk about teacher as a reflective practitioner. Now, who is a reflective practitioner? Who is an effective teacher? The answer to this we'll try to find out. What is reflection? Look at this slide. You find that teach is being reflected as learn. So, when we teach, we learn a lot. Every teaching experience gives us a new learning experience as well. So, we learn while teaching, we learn about our mistakes and we try to improve upon them in the next class. So, let's reflect on the pedagogical aspects of teaching. You think, what is a good lesson? Who is a good teacher? The one who is able to teach well. The one whose class the students learn effectively. And understand the need to think about our teaching and reflect upon it so that we, every time we teach, we improve our teaching process, our teaching experience. So, expand our understanding of the teaching learning process. Every time I teach in the class, I learn lots of things about the teaching learning process, how students learn. Enlarge our range of options as effective teachers. How to be more effective in our teaching practice. And then it helps us to enhance learning opportunities for our students. Since we are learning along with the students and we are providing them better opportunities than the previous lesson. So, this way we improve our teaching practice. Now, let's reflect. What is reflective practice? The first thing is taking action to improve on what one has learned. Every time we improve, every time we learn, it is linking thought and action objectively, means without any bias to make changes. So, we should be open to criticism. We should be open to changes. It involves thinking about and critically analyzing one's actions with the goal of improving one's professional practice. So, now reflecting and identifying the problem in the class. What I have taught in the class, where I was very good, where there was a problem and the students could not understand, what areas of change I have identified. Is it in my questioning skill? Is it in my ability to demonstrate? Is it in my ability to present myself in the class? Maybe the presentations I have given in the class has a poor pacing. It is taking more time. So, we have to think of an action plan. What to do next? And for that, I need to know what exactly I want to change, where I went wrong. So, all this necessary information is needed. Now, how will I know that I am making improvement? What are the indicators? What change should happen in the class? Maybe if I find that, oh, my presentation has finished on time, that means my teaching was effective this time. That means I have improved. So, this is how reflection helps the teacher. The result of the action taken in the classroom is the difference that I made in the present class as compared to the previous class. What changes has taken place in the student learning process? So, I find that this time the students got more work done and their learning rate has also increased. That means I have improved my teaching. So, let's reflect on our teaching. Think about a lesson you taught. You must have taught something in the class. Then describe a part of that lesson that went very well. Oh, very good. And how it went well, what happened? And describe a part of the lesson that did not go well. And why it did not go well, where I went wrong. And what can I do differently to make that part go better? What can I do to improve that? Where lies the problem? In the class, the problems may lie, number one, in teacher preparation. I have not prepared my lesson well. I have not prepared the activities. And then during lesson delivery, maybe I am not delivering my lesson effectively. Maybe I am very fast in the class, maybe I am very slow. And then the content, sometimes the content is very difficult and sometimes it's very easy, sometimes it's very boring. So I have to make my classroom teaching interesting. And then the students, even they might not be interested in the class, maybe due to any reason, or they have not acquired the previous knowledge necessary for this lesson. And in the classroom, there may be distractions in the classroom. Maybe the light is not proper, maybe the air is not proper, it's very hot inside, and the other factors as well. Let's say there's a match going on in the playground and the noise is not allowing me to teach well. Now, when we talk about reflective practitioner, then the question is, who is a reflective practitioner? A person who learns from experiences and planning what she or he would do in a similar situation in future, and then tries better strategies. For example, a teacher plans to use inquiry-based teaching so that the students learn well. The origin of reflective practice starts with John Dewey. He is considered to be the first educational theorist to suggest that teachers can improve their practice. He defined reflective thought as active, persistent, careful consideration of any belief or knowledge in the light of grounds that support it and further conclusions to which it tends. Many educationists say different things about reflection. Brookfield and says, in reflective practice, practitioners engage in continuous cycle of self-observation and self-evaluation in order to understand their own actions and the reaction they prompt in themselves and in the learners. That is, action followed by reaction followed by correction, and again an improved action, again reaction, again further correction. Now, what Cunningham says? He says the goal of refractive practice is not necessarily to address a specific problem or question defined at the beginning, but to observe and refine practice in general and on an ongoing basis. This improvement is not for one time, it's for ongoing always. J. Webb says, if we are to become more effective teachers, we need to become more reflective teachers. To be reflective, we need to articulate our theories of learning, critically examine them, and replace those parts which we suspect, or better still, can show that they don't work. So we need to replace them with the new strategies that actually work in the class. To become reflective teachers, John Dewey says, three attitudes are necessary. One is open-minded. I should be open to criticism. I should be open to change myself wherever required. I should be open to question myself. And then I should be responsible, because I know that I am the one who is responsible for students' learning. If the students don't learn well, then who is responsible? Of course, it is the teacher. And then comes the wholeheartedness. I am very much willing to teach. I am passionate about teaching, and I actually learn, I actually want that the students learn in my class. So reflective teaching is exploring underlying beliefs in teaching practice, self-observation, self-evaluation, knowing where I went wrong, and then the process of observing and collecting information related to our own behavior in the class and behavior of others like the students. It means to institute meaningful changes and improvements in our teaching. A beneficial form of professional development. What is it? Every time I improve, I become professionally more competent. So this is reflective teaching. Reflection opportunities come in a number of ways. It helps us to enhance students' learning. Students learn better with a reflective teacher. It enhances professional development as an academician. Every time the teacher learns new things, becomes more competent. In reflective practice, I mean to say, that it is the capacity to reflect on action so as to engage in a process of continuous learning. I am learning continuously because I am going to, I want to be a good teacher. I am a lifelong learner, which is one of the defining characteristics of professional practice. The more you practice, the more you improve, the more you reflect, the better teacher you become. The modern concept of reflective practice is given by Donald Tron. He has introduced the term knowledge in action, which refers to the kind of knowledge that is revealed in the way we carry out our tasks and we approach the problems that come in the teaching practice. This professional knowledge increases with each reflective teaching experience and allows teachers to continually take action based on this knowledge, continuously correcting oneself and becoming a better teacher. Donald Tron defined reflective process as consisting of three key aspects. First is reflection in action. While teaching in the class, I find that my question has not brought many responses from the students. That means something is wrong with my teaching. So I have to improve, that is in action. Then on action. Reflection on action takes place before I enter the class and it takes place when I come back from the class. Then reflection for action, so for improvement, for thinking of new strategies, for thinking of new action that I may take in future so that my class is good. Zechner and Liston, they have given a model on reflective teaching. They say that reflective teaching lists five key features of teacher as reflective practitioner. One thing is, a reflective teacher examines, frames and attempts to solve the problems of classroom practice. Every problem has its own solution, so that the teacher examines. Then a reflective teacher is aware of the questions, assumptions, the objectives and the values she or he brings to the teaching in her class or in his class. So this is the second key feature of a good reflective practitioner that Zechner and Liston's model states. Then comes the third feature, which says that it is being attentive to the institutional and cultural context in which she or he teaches. Every institution has its own goals, own objectives, and it should be culturally relevant also. The teacher takes part in curriculum development. The teacher takes responsibility for his own professional development, keeps on trying. It doesn't mean that somebody, some outsider says, okay, now you reflect. No, a good teacher reflects, is responsible for his own professional development. So these are the five things that Zechner and Liston have listed. They have identified five traditions of reflective practice that have guided reform efforts in teaching and teacher education. And the first one of them is the academic side, that is, how much content has to be taught in the class, what is to be taught, is that content relevant, how to make it joyful, how to make it, you know, more meaningful to the students. So the academic tradition focuses on reflecting on course content and how it is taught to promote student understanding, finding out joyful ways of teaching the students so that they learn better. They learn the course content, which is very important for them, because our assessment is all based on the academics. Then comes the social efficiency tradition. This refers to using methodology rooted in scientific research, proven good practices as the basis of instruction and the standard by which teachers reflect upon their work. Then comes the developmentalist tradition. It emphasizes reflecting on one's approach based on students' background, their interests, their thinking, and their developmental stage, their academic level. So how much they can understand, what is their mental age, what will be appropriate for their age level. Then comes the social reconstructionist tradition. This stresses reflection about social and political context of schooling and the assessment of classroom actions to enhance equality, justice and more humane conditions in schools and society. This also means inclusion of all the students irrespective of their background, irrespective of their abilities in the classroom. Then comes the generic tradition that represents what the general reflecting teachers do in their work without attention to the quality or substance of that thinking. So we sum up all these things and that becomes a good teaching. So good teaching needs to attend to all the elements that are highlighted by this these things. Now, levels of reflections listed by Zechner and Liston. The first level is rapid. In the class, while teaching, there are immediate and automatic decisions, often while teaching constantly and often done privately. The teacher goes on changing the examples, goes on changing the questions, goes on changing the strategies of teaching so that the students learn better. So this is rapid. Then there comes repair, thoughtful decision to alter behavior based upon students' clues. Review means it's less formal, done at a particular point of time. What I have done, what was wrong, what was right. So teacher writes, thinks, discusses some of the elements with colleagues. This is how I done. And this was the problem, what to do next. So they think in a group so that the next teaching is always better than the previous one. So this is how we review. And after reviewing, we research. It is again review, but in a systematic manner over a period of time. We think, we observe on a particular issue and then we take action, like we undertake an action research. The students in my class don't want to write. Why they don't want to write? What are the reasons? So let us perform an action research on it, exploratory practices, and then going through teaching journals, then re-theorizing and reformulating the things long term and informed by public and academic theories. So this action is influenced by academic theories. It is more rigorous. Now we come to tools of reflection. How we reflect? We reflect through our lesson notes. We write down our notes in the lesson plans. Then teacher diary is one where we write, this is what I am going to teach today, this method I am going to use today, this is how I am going to assess. So your teacher diary is again a tool of reflection. After teacher diary comes peer observation. Maybe one of your colleagues sits in the class and observes your class, writes down some comments for you. So that becomes peer observation. That's a tool for thinking, tool of reflection. And you can also get a video prepared of your classroom teaching, an audio of how you speak in the class, prepared of your classroom teaching. And by watching them, you try to find out where I can improve. So that again is a very good tool of reflection. And then comes students' feedback. This feedback can be oral while asking questions in the class, or it may be written when I take a class test, how the students have performed the test. If they have performed very well, that means yes, I have taught well. If they have not performed well, means I have to think why they could not perform well, what went wrong with them. Then professional portfolio, this I'll keep on adding my experiences in my portfolio, my successes, my failures. So everything is a good learning experience for the next teaching of my life, my professional life. So these are the tools of reflection. Now how do I write my reflections? How do I prepare note of my reflections from these tools? They are the methods of recording reflections. The first thing is a narrative. Let me write down my experiences in the form of a story. Story of an experience or an event written in the first person. I taught this in the class. The students did not bring their geometry boxes and this is how I felt very bad and this is how I managed, you know. and then writing in reflective journals, a reaction to the event or experience looked upon in different ways, linking the experience with other experiences and learning from each situation for the future action. So these are the methods of recording reflections. So both are important, tools and methods. So today we studied about reflective practice. Let's summarize. Reflective practice involves thinking and critically analyzing one's actions with the goal of improving one's professional practice. Three attitudes are necessary for reflection. They are open-mindedness, responsibility, and wholeheartedness. So these three attitudes are important. Then we studied that reflection enhances students' learning and professional development of a teacher. Then we studied that Donald Schoen used the term knowledge in action for kind of knowledge that is revealed in the way we approach problems. And the tools of reflection we studied are lesson notes, teacher diary, peer observation, video, audio recordings, student feedback, and professional portfolio. And then we found that reflections can be recorded through narratives and reflective journals. So today we studied about reflective practices, and I hope that by going through this lesson, you will be a very good reflective practitioner in your life and do well in your teaching profession. Best of luck. Thank you.